Always a favourite on every rural road. Hyundai Country Calendar.
What we do is slightly different to everybody else.
People say, you know, there was life before mulberries and then there was life after mulberries.
They're a very seductive little piece of fruit.
Whatever doesn't get eaten on the orchard gets bottled.
And we just need to keep working hard at providing folks with awesome fruit. One of the ambitions that we had was to develop our little property into a fruit salad orchard. We grow apricots, cherries, nectarines, peaches, plums, greengages. We have tomatoes, courgettes. We grow purple passion potatoes. We grow apples, old heritage varieties of apples, pears, nashi pears. We have mulberries, walnuts. We even have fig trees, so a bit of everything on this little property.
7 years ago, Mike Darling decided he'd had enough of being a detective in the police force and, along with wife Helen, went looking for a new project, preferably near where he grew up. They found it here, 10 hectares of rundown orchard close to Cromwell in central Otago.
There's a lot of folk in the immediate area that are more of a single variety orchards. There's a lot of very large corporate cherry orchards in the area now, and those folk have got quite incredible scale and big opportunity in international markets. We decided that we'd be a smaller fruit salad orchard which can supply folk with the fruit of yesteryear. On our property here, we try and plant and coordinate our varieties to mature through from early December to end of March. In doing that, we can have a small labour requirement. Because we're only a small family orchard anyway, we can call on family members to help out when we're stuck, and then we can just have one or two regulars that can get us through.
How's it looking, Zoe?
Okay, it's just
ripe enough or not? It's too green.
A little bit.
I think they're better than the Fantasia though,
yeah,
to be fair.
Yeah.
While Zoe is the only full-time orchard worker, there is a seasonal worker in the busy times. And Mike's son Hamish, a law student, is often here to help. Today is a rare day in central Otago. It's raining.
We're pretty super dry and often be pouring down only, you know, 20 or 30 k's away. We're in a wee rain shadow here. We're one of the driest areas of New Zealand, really. But it's unusual to get a bit of rain. No predicting the climate in today's world.
Fruit like nectarines thrive in the extremes of hot and cold.
Come the winter, it's not uncommon to have -5, -6, even -10. Then at the other end, we're having 36s last week. It certainly causes some of our fruit to melt if it's got too ripe on us.
It's physical work, but it has its rewards.
It's actually a pretty satisfying day's work when you come in and you've had the picking bag on for the day. Your old back's a bit sore and you've got a bit of sun. It's a good feeling, you know.
The orchard is named Moorpark in Mulberry, after a heritage variety of apricots called Moorpark. Some of these trees are 80 years old.
These are one of the very early apricots that have been grown in central Otago and in New Zealand. They're an intense flavour and a very succulent. They're an amazing piece of fruit. We hold our fruit a wee bit longer on the tree. We pay a big price for that because it's much harder to manage. And we lose a lot with over-ripening, which end up going out to the sheep or out to the pigs. But they are sweeter because of that.
How's it going?
Good.
Mike's wife Helen has created several international food-related companies from her Auckland office. Her skills and experience are invaluable on the orchard.
The name Moorpark in Mulberry was one of Helen's inventions, and it serves us super well because we're all about old-fashioned values, old-fashioned flavours and old-fashioned folk who are keen to get that type of fruit experience.
The mulberry trees were also here when the Darlings arrived.
They're actually considered to be a super fruit, so they're very high in antioxidant properties and lots of nice vitamins and minerals. But the best thing about them is they taste fantastic. I think one of the really cool things about selling them here is that you let people taste them for the first time, and people come in and say, you know, there was life before mulberries and then there was life after mulberries, and we have people just about knocking down the door wanting them in the summertime. They're pretty special. I really enjoy them, and I must admit that I'm quite happy when the shop shuts in the summertime and I can pick all excess fruit, I freeze it, and I have smoothies all winter.
Despite the rave reviews, mulberries aren't well known in New Zealand.
I just think that they're a fruit that it's very difficult to harvest. As you can see, it's very messy, very time consuming, very, very labour intensive. The birds love them. So a lot of people will have mulberry trees but won't have ever seen any ripe fruit because the birds manage to get there before them.
Home.
Every piece of fruit, including these nectarines, goes through quality control.
A little bit faster or you're right?
We'll go touch.
Every last piece of fruit is used, starting from the highest end, best primo fruit, which goes in a gift tray and we can ask a premium dollar for, right through to the last ones that Molly and Princess eat out in the sheep paddock.
Leaving fruit on the tree to ripen has meant a learning curve in the grading and packing shed.
The first years when we were trying to grade Moorpark apricots, they were all so ripe that they slipped through the rollers on the grader, which wasn't ideal. We've learned a lot since those days.
Dad built this out of his brother's old broken down grader, didn't you?
Both our boys are fully involved in what we do here. They're demanding some pretty high-end director's fees, but I think we're going to have to generate a bit more income before that's going to become a reality.
Hamish made his parents proud when he won a Young Horticulturalist Award.
It was a real treat. I won the Central Otago competition and then went on to go up to Napier and do the rest of the competition up there, where I came third, but we got to go up to Auckland and meet a bunch of movers and shakers in the industry, and so that's pretty neat. I'd love to do what Dad did and come to it in a few years. I'm still pretty keen on exploring the world and seeing what there is to offer, but yeah, I'd love to come back to a small plot and grow some fruit. It's pretty cool.
Mike sees it slightly differently.
Perhaps I still haven't decided what I'll be when I grow up, but working for the police was an interesting interlude and one that I wouldn't swap. It was pretty exciting times, and I sort of thought when I left school that going off and working for the police would be an easier career than growing fruit. And now I've come back to fruit growing, I've realised that early proposition is absolutely accurate.
Certainly, you know, you actually want that juice coming out there.
But Mike's police background has given him the people skills that help make their roadside shop a success.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
The roadside stall on Helen and Mike Darling's Central Otago Orchard is a core part of their operation.
Hey, hi, Kim. How are you? Good, thank you.
Good.
I'd say we probably sell about 40% of our production out of our roadside store. We built this up from 0% when we first took over 6 years ago when it was completely run down.
Hello, how are you? Like to try a Moorpark apricot?
Yes, thank you.
It's always the way. Careful, they make a mess of your shirt.
Thank you. Well, that means they're juicy, huh?
The interaction with the folk that come in shopping is an amazing experience.
This is the taste of Central Otago summer.
Everybody wants to learn something and wants that personal interaction with folk that know about their fruit.
You actually want that juice coming out. Not too many people grow these anymore because they're, you pick 100 kilograms, you only get to sell 50 because they ripen so fast.
But the shop sells more than just fruit.
It's my wife's art. She's got a wee studio at the back there and turns out the odd piece. But last year we got frosted really badly. She sold more art than I did fruit. So that was a good thing.
While Mike manages the orchard, His wife Helen runs her businesses from her Auckland office. When she's at home, she finds time to create lino-cut prints.
I lead quite a busy life in terms of my work, and when you're doing art, you have to immerse yourself in it. It's almost, it is therapeutic. With lino cutting, where everything is in reverse and upside down, you can only think about what you're doing. You can't be thinking about work problems or what you want to be doing next. It's just, at that time, the line that you're cutting.
Helen has sold out of the first company she set up, Oratane. It identifies where a product comes from.
They can determine where something has originated from. So they collect chemical data about what a product should look like if it was produced in a certain area. Whether this particular apple came from Central Otago or Hawke's Bay or China.
Helen's latest startup is called Food Truths. It harnesses big data to identify problems in food chains around the world.
I see problems and I want to do something about them. The opportunity to make a difference is, I guess, what gets me up in the morning. I don't want to sort of go to bed at night and go, oh, well, it was a ho-hum day. But actually doing something that will make things better is what drives me.
Her other hobby is equally creative.
I do sometimes get distracted when I'm at my computer. If I can hear like the plovers in the paddock next door going mad, it's because there's a hawk around and they're protecting their young, and so that's always a good photo opportunity.
The subjects of Helen's photos are the birds around the orchard.
We've got such a wide variety of birds. If you put aside the nasty starlings and blackbirds and thrushes, our quails that bob around the orchard in the springtime and falcons that come in and eat the quails that are bobbing around the orchard, you name it. It's a bit of a menagerie, really. Traditionally, the relationship between orchardists and birds isn't a happy one. They tend to do a lot of damage on the orchard. That being said, we've also noticed that birds such as waxeyes actually assist with pollination, so it's not all negative. Capturing birds is always a challenge because they won't sit still and do as you've asked. It's something that you've got to be able to move quickly with, and that's always a challenge. You never know if you're going to actually get a hawk in flight or not. It's challenging and creative and, yeah, just fun. I think everybody needs to have a creative outlet, and I know that when I'm highly creative, I'm also really much better at problem solving in my day job, so they both contribute to each other. Good. Pleased with it? Quite a fat bird.
When Mike and Helen arrived, the orchard was pretty run down. It needed a lot of work.
The whole place has been completely redone, really, and there's probably 6,000 trees here, and we've kept 300 of the original trees.
All the irrigation and frost protection systems had to be replaced.
He sold me that this would be a great lifestyle. I'm waiting for the days of sitting on the deck, having a nice cup of tea and not doing anything. Yeah, it hasn't happened yet.
The latest project is planting natives to attract more birds. Just months after they moved onto the orchard, they discovered the strength of community when Mike suffered a major heart attack.
I had been away for a conference, came home and found Michael nearly dead. He had an unexpected and probably unexplained heart event, which ended up having still cardiac surgery and being out of action for 6 months. The positive side of it all was I'd been a bit of a reluctant migrant from the city and come up here and suddenly found I had an orchard to run and a youngest son still in high school.
Although Mike and Helen were new to the neighbourhood, the community rallied around.
The neighbours just turned up and I had help with lambing and frost fighting and planting trees and thinning and just whenever there was anything that needed to be done, there'd be somebody here who'd be knocking on my door to help, and it was great.
Mike was told that for 6 months he wasn't to lift anything heavier than a 2-litre bottle of milk.
It was a difficult time, and it's time to reflect too and to try and work out the most important things.
I believe that Mike's health really improved the day I picked up his chainsaw and came inside and said, does it matter if you get mud in it? And he got out of his chair pretty quick that day and hasn't looked back.
The darlings have beehives on their orchard to pollinate the fruit, but bees don't venture into the glasshouse. A few bumblebees do, but not in sufficient numbers to do the business.
Bumblebees will work in cooler temperatures, so any time we can see bumblebees inside the glasshouse here is a real bonus. However, you know, for the first few years, we grew amazing tomato plants, but very few tomatoes. So it was a wee bit of trial and error, and soon realised that pollination was a big issue for us. We reverted to Zoe's secret electric toothbrush technique to manage pollination. It's all organically grown in here, so apart from some concoctions that Zoe makes up using comfrey tea and seaweed fertilisers, we use no chemicals or any sprays whatsoever in here.
Despite their best efforts, things can still go wrong. Last year, a severe frost nearly ruined them. Central Otago's extremes of weather make running an orchard difficult.
So we understand how that's varying.
Mike and Helen Darling's geologist son Matt and his mate Nick Humphreys have created a climate monitoring system for the orchard.
Well, we have one sensor just below the surface and then one a bit deeper. And that way we'll be able to see how much the water's seeping into the ground.
It's just the way they're doing it.
How's it going?
Good, yeah.
With water, you know, it's a scarce resource, and one, as a horticulturalist, we have to work hard to care for. And we want to optimise our tree health, our fruit quality, but we certainly do not want to waste a single drop. It's precious. We've got temperature probes in a number of strategic locations across the property. They will also measure humidity. We'll have soil moisture sensors.
So given I'm not actually signed off on the use of a spade and the
Mulberry Bush. That really doesn't surprise me, because Matt, this here is the digging end.
Oh.
This is the one you hold with. So
we'll have the ability to notify us when our home property water tank is running low, so we can manage that. We have security cameras which hook into that same system. And the other biggie, which will come in the very near future, is management of our wind machine.
On the orchard, a severe frost at the wrong time can destroy a whole year's work.
13th of October, we lost 80% of our crop, possibly more. But that was a devastating, massive frost. And it was a pretty difficult time.
On the day of the 13th, we had so much fruit. And we'd actually made the mistake of walking down the first row, row 10, and saying, we've got a lot of fruit to thin. And then we had that frost. We walked down the row on the 14th, and it was amazing. The fruit had just gone over the space of, it was a 6-hour frost, wasn't it? We threw everything we could at it, and the wind machine was going, but then we had helicopters all around us on neighbouring properties that we were competing with. It was extremely sobering, and we walked around and felt like we'd failed the trees and knew that we weren't going to have any fruit, and it was a couple of days of sort of going, well, what are we going to do? It was tough, and it was a reminder that actually that we're not in charge, that what nature throws at you, nature throws at you.
This is the ultimate in bird protection. I challenge any bird to get their beak into this bad boy. This is actually a wee project that we're doing with Cadrona Distillery. They were super keen for us to have a try at growing some fruit in bottles. This is the result of that project.
Cadrona Distillery was started by Ash and Desiree Whittaker 5 years ago.
So we've had a little bit more success than last year. Mind you, that frost didn't help much.
No, it didn't. It's fantastic. Look at them.
So those two red gold nectarines.
Really impressed with, you know, the size of the fruit that you've got in there. It's amazing.
Yeah, that's done quite well. Certainly it's a learning curve, but...
Well, here you go, you might as well do the honours.
Oh, you reckon?
Absolutely.
I'll probably end up dropping it or making an idiot of myself.
It's not that hard. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Mike and I actually met in hospital about 4 years ago and developed a friendship, and we started, just was an idea that came up. We thought, well, let's give it a go. We only got that one bottle the first year, frosted last year, of course, and we've had another crack again this year. So, look, it's exciting. You're not looking for a part-time job.
Most of the Darling's fruit is sold in Otago, but some ends up here at Vanier Patisserie in Auckland's Parnell.
Sonia is an amazing artisan producer of high-end pastries and goodies up in Auckland, and we're delighted to be able to send her produce to enhance what she does.
Sonia Helmonte went looking for quality fruit to match the quality of her baking.
It's incredible, it's actually Google. We try to find small orchards because we do love to work with local producers as much as possible, and especially when they're small families, because we're a small family business as well. I'm actually Kiwi Thai German, but lived in France. I had my chef experience in Paris for 7 years, and then with my husband, who's French, we decided to come back here.
Where she found Mike and Helen's tree-ripened fruit.
They are probably the best. The difference, I think, is they pick up the fruits when it's just ripe, which makes a huge difference in terms of flavours, rather than picking them up earlier and leaving it to ripe naturally afterwards. So ripened fruits on trees just has a lot more flavours. Absolutely, so that's why we love their fruits.
So what trees are these?
These are spring bright.
The success of Moorpark and Mulberry Orchard is based on complementary talents.
Mike's really good talking to people. I am not so good in the shop, for example, whereas Mike is great.
And Helen's strengths are around strategy and thinking through how we're going to make this business grow and how it's going to pay for itself. One day down the track, we're pretty sure.
How is it going to pay for itself?
I'm not quite sure yet, but we'll keep working on that.
Calendar was brought to you by Hyundai New Zealand.